Richard Edgar's been allowed out today. He's at the Chelsea Flower Show. Richard, how's it looking?
The editor of Breakfast News is going to get me a new studio, but I'm impressed, Tim. This is wonderful. Now, if you're coming to show this week, they're expecting something like about 170,000 visitors to the show, and during that time, they eat something like a staggering 80,000 ice creams. Is it going to be ice cream weather today across the country?
Ah, you caught me just potting up a little bit of mint to give me some early shoots in spring, but come with me because there's more to do in the garden at this time of year.
Well, our celebrity this week is a well-known television face, and boy, what a face he's got.
I joined the Royal Navy in 1979, came in as officer air crew, and that brought me down to the south coast into such places as Daedalus, Leon Solent, and also here.
What was it like, though, in the Falklands when you were actually flying around what was obviously a potentially very dangerous situation?
It was a brilliant environment, actually, to work in a war environment where you're all doing your job for real rather than doing an exercise. It just pulled everybody together, all the services working together. Terrific camaraderie between everybody, whether the Army, Navy, or Air Force.
With its majestic position above Dartmouth, Britannia Royal Naval College has been the prestigious launch pad for thousands of young officers. It was here a young Princess Elizabeth met Prince Philip, and over the years, many a royal prince has passed through these doors.
And here we are in the senior gun room, this magnificent hall, this dining room where the naval greats of the past have wined and dined. Such men as Admiral Nelson, Jellicoe, Earl Mountbatten, and Edgar. Yes, here we are. It's me and Prince Andrew, Hawk Division, Easter 1980.
Edgar! Is that you? I don't believe you're still wearing that same poncy outfit you wore the day you joined the Navy. Best thing you've ever done is join a bunch of cities.
Now, let's turn our attention to the weather, and somebody has a lot to answer for.
I'm sorry, Russell. No, it all went just as forecast. And in fact, my surfing friends at number 33 tell me it was a fine afternoon up on the north coast, but we went south to view the weather at Lyme Regis.
Now, on to our own high flyer, Richard Edgar. Now, I know you can fly, Richard, but don't get any big ideas in there and don't touch anything, for goodness sake.
Why are you coming into Exeter? Because I didn't think Concorde could actually get into Exeter.
Well, Exeter's not a long runway, but it's long enough for Concorde.
Well, we heard earlier about a shortage of blood. We know they're looking for volunteers, and Richard couldn't wait to pop down to Derriford. How are you getting on, Richard?
Well, we're doing very well these time here. I've got the BBC Globe in my hand. Marion's been looking after me. And I tell you what, she's been sucking me dry.
Now, last night, Richard promised us there wouldn't be a hurricane, but you didn't say anything about an earthquake. We can rely on the weathermen, eh?
Lisa, do you want blood?
No, we had that a couple of nights ago.
We've been rehearsing that all day. Well done, Russell. You came in just on time there. What can I say? I'm sorry about the earthquake. Well, let's take a look at some sporting action around other parts of the world. Let's go, first of all, into Trinidad, where the cricket continues. West Indies versus England, no problems with the rain there. In fact, it's going to be fine, dry and sunny, top temperatures to around about 32 degrees. Not quite so warm back in the United Kingdom. Sky certainly looking bright, but rather cloudy outside my News 24 weather window. Looking to the west, out of Bristol, the sun is up. But again, there's quite a bit of cloud around. You notice some gaps in the clouds, or sunny spells in some areas today. But to the northwest, that's where our next weather action's coming from, the rain down from that direction.
And welcome to Jersey. We're here in St. Helier at the Grand Hotel. We've got 300 children having a wonderful party. If you want to join us, get on down here. If you can't get on down here, watch us for the real fireworks later.
Hello, welcome back to Jersey, where we are plucking hairs for Putsy. This is Liz in her lovely white uniform. Just look at this lot. This is the man in charge. He's Form Master Bates. This is Steve. And this is Jason, who I think is very pleased to see me.
And who is it?
It's Toppy
BBC weather forecaster Richard Edgar. Oh, welcome to the programme.
Thank you, Diane. There's an early Christmas present
for
you.
Oh, lovely, yeah.
OK, but looking at records like this, which only really cover local areas, how do we get a complete picture of the whole country?
Well, there was a gentleman called Professor Gordon Manlin. He took all the information from these sort of diaries and from other areas. He pieced them all together, a little jigsaw, and filled in the gaps and gave us those continuous records back to 1659.
But how did these amateurs actually measure the weather?
Yes, and they measure the weather as well. Come on over here, I'll show you. Look, we've got some early examples of weather instruments here. This is the first one. This is a rain gauge.